Anyway, good to have you here this morning, all of you, whether in here or whether in overflow. Welcome to Antioch Baptist Church. We are glad to have you. I am especially glad to see our Honduras team back today. Honduras team, welcome home. Equally as happy to see our Vermont mission team back today. Give them a hand as well. Welcome home, guys. So glad to have them back safely. Please be in prayer as our Alaska team, at least a couple of those members will be headed out next Sunday, if I'm not mistaken. So please be in prayer for that. And then the rest of the team will join them in just a few weeks to follow. But please continue to remember all of these missions, even though Vermont is back, even though our Honduras team is back. Pray that the work will be ongoing and that the seeds that they planted will grow to fruition and become hearts that love and know the Lord and are walking with Him. But we are glad to have you back. And also for our visitors today, I see a few new faces. If you're visiting with us, just relax. I know it's hard being in a different place and wondering, what are people thinking of me? What they're thinking is, I'm glad they're here. And so we are glad you are here. You've been here more than 5 minutes, so consider yourself a part of the family. As you know, it is Bible school week, and if you didn't know, it's Bible school week. We don't always have a full-blown train station running here at Antioch, but this week you are at Salvation Station, and we will be going through Bible school each night through Wednesday. 5 o'clock meal tonight, 6:30 beginning time each night for Bible school throughout Wednesday. Now listen, I know it has been traditionally for young people. Our Bible schools for the last 7 years have not been just for young people. There is a class for adults. We've got a wonderful teacher. Brother Roger Honeycutt will be teaching that this week. So all the way from the cradle to the grave, we have classes. So come on and join us at Salvation Station. And if you think this get up is something, we're not even done yet. We had to wait for the choir to get out of here this afternoon so we could finish decorating. But I do want to give Bible school a big plug and explain to you sort of why we look like we're in a train station. Let me just say this. There are real train tracks here, real spikes, real everything. When I fall, please laugh. Please. You know I can't stand still and preach. Don't even wait for me to get up, okay? Just laugh, because no matter what happens, I'm good. But we do want to welcome you here today. And if you are visiting, fill out a visitor's card for us. Just drop it in the offering plate as you're offering to us. There are some in the back of the pews. And that is not so we can send you a bunch of junk mail or call you a million times. We're going to send you one little card that gives you our contact info so that if we can ever serve you as we serve the Lord, you'll know how to find us, okay? So do that, and please make yourself at home. We're just here to do one thing, and that is to worship the Lord today. So let's stand as we do that. Our call to worship is right there in the bulletin. If you're able to stand, please do, and let's sing Standing on the Promises this morning. Ever greet your neighbors this morning.
Good morning. Welcome once again to Antioch Baptist Church. Welcome back, Pastor Dave. Glad to have you back as well. You turn over to the back of your bulletins, we'll go over the announcements. But first, a couple cards. Dear Antioch Church family, thank you all so much for opening your church to me and allowing me to share with y'all about our mission trip to Moldova. Thank you for contributing to our trip financially, but most importantly, thank you for your prayers and Christ's love, Kristen Garrett and the Red Mountain Baptist Church Moldova mission team. Antioch Church family, some people say a dog is a dog. Some people know the dog is someone who loves you unconditionally. Wolf was part of my family. He was in my family for 10 and a half years. He gave me his hair, his wet kisses, and all of his heart. I want to thank you for the sympathy card in remembrance of Wolf and for knowing my heart was breaking with his loss. God bless you and thank you for showing you cared. Love, Alice Smith and Wolf. And now the announcements. There will be a huge camp meeting after services in the youth room today. If you have not noticed, Bible school starts today, in case you somehow missed all of that. And it's going to run from this evening at 5 all the way through Wednesday evening. So no men's Bible study this week, no exercise class, and no handbell practice in lieu of a vacation Bible school. Please come out and enjoy it with us. Also, we will be delivering goods to the Person County Sheriff's Department this month. And guys that still owe me money for the men's advance, I need that on July the 9th. So balances for men's advance due on July 9th. Pastor Dave?
All right. One other announcement I do want to mention. Today is also Survivor Sunday. That's why we have the beautiful purple and white flower arrangement here, as well as this one solitary candle burning. And this is in honor of all of our cancer survivors. It's also in memory of those who have gone on to be with the Lord because of this dread disease. You know that we have been a very active church in regards to Relay for Life ever since Relay for Life started. I'll never forget the first one. I think there were roughly 180-some people, if I'm not mistaken. We raised $1,200. We walked from PCC to the fish house up there on the, right across from the high school, and we thought we'd done something. Well, as the years went on, this community came together and began to make Relay for Life something more and more beautiful and larger each year. In fact, for many years, are earning more per capita than any other relay in the country. Just shows the loving nature and commitment of this community, and we will remain committed to that. We do have a team this year. You can see Cindy O'Brien, Robert O'Brien, if you'd like to know more about our team this year. If you want to know more about Relay in general, please see Daphne Hutchins or Maris Ashley. They'd be glad to share with you a little more about that. But in that vein today, I do want to mention to you that we do have, and please tell me, Daphne, this is Cancer Survivors Forms for the meal. Is that correct? Okay, these are invitations for our cancer survivors. We'd like for you to get those, fill them out, and get them back to me or either Daphne. And Daphne, I know you don't want to, but please stand for a moment. Say, no, get these two. All right. You can get these to me or Daphne as soon as possible. There will be a meal in your recognition, and this is to get your ticket for that. This is free of charge for you as survivors. You are our heroes. You have fought through a very dread disease. But with that being said, I would love at this time if we could have all of our cancer survivors. Now listen closely, folks. If you have had any form of cancer, whether it be a small blemish on your face that had to be frozen off or something like that, right on up to the most serious of cancers. If you are one of our cancer survivors, would you please come down front this morning and let us see you and love on you, and we have a very special gift for you as well. So please come up, survivors. Will you make sure that gets into the parlor for me? Come on up. Don't be shy. Come and stand in front of these luminaries that spell out hope today. You had hope when this started that you would survive this. God saw fit to make that happen. You also know that we had hope as your Christian family, as your community, and that we prayed for you diligently. Now, folks, we do this for a couple of reasons. I want you to take a look at how many people got up out of their seats and walked to the front of this church this morning. Folks that are coming from overflow. This is a lot of people. Cancer is a very serious thing. And listen, we all know that cancer will be cured in God's time, if it is in God's time. But we also know that we have to put hands and feet on our prayers, and we need to do something to try to speed that process along and be instruments in His hands. And that's what Relay for Life is about, this right here. It's about trying to get the research done so that the cure can be found, so that people who are dealing with this can get through it. Because for every one you see standing here, there were about 10, according to statistics, in our community that did not make it. Now think about that. So you guys are our heroes in a very big way. And you say, I'm not a hero, I just did what I had to do. That's what heroes are. People who face insurmountable odds and do what they need to do to get through it. And we, your family, loved you as you were going through it. If you are still going through it, we still love you. We prayed then. We'll keep praying, because there is always hope in prayer. Amen. Because God is the God of hope. But we want to give you just a little something today. Daphne's going to come through. Where are you at, Daphne? Oh, there you are. We have a beautiful pen. These are just little flowers. Most of them are purple, some teal. For our ladies, these are just little pens to remind you that you are so loved and that you are still being prayed for, even if you've gotten past it. You know, sometimes you get over something and you think, oh, well, everybody's forgotten me now. Yeah, not true. These are to remind you that you are remembered. Also, for the men, because we just didn't figure y'all wanted to wear little purple flowers, although some of you might. But we have a beautiful silver cross for you fellas to wear for the very same purpose, to remind you of where your hope lies and that we love you and we're praying for you always. But before they go back to their seats, because every one of them like, can we go back now? No, we want you to stay up here and be uncomfortable for a minute more. Before you go back, we're going to make you a part of our morning prayer this morning. And also remembering those who are dealing with cancer in our community that are not here today, who are a part of our sister churches and other churches in the community. So let's pray for these folks. Let's pray for the rest of our service. Father God, we are grateful. We are so grateful that today these folks are here for us to give these small tokens of our love. These small tokens reminding them that we're not done praying for them and we never will be. Thank you for seeing fit to heal these folks, God, because we sure do love them. We sure are glad they're in our midst. And God, it's been amazing to watch how each and every one of them have traversed their ordeal with cancer. They've done so knowing that either way they were okay because they belong to you. They did so with grace and with class. They did so knowing that your will was what mattered in their life. And yet, God, it's been our honor and privilege to pray for them and to pray for all of those who have battled cancer. But, Father, even as we celebrate these, we know that there are many that we have had to say, see you later, because of this dread disease. And so for their families, I lift them up, God, and ask you to give them peace and comfort and endurance in these times. But Father, we are grateful that no matter what, you are in control, and that there will come a time, we believe, when there will be a cure, and I pray that you would show us how to be a part of that. That's why we relay, because of these folks that are so special to us, and because we want to do something more. So please use us in that regard and bless Relay this year, even as we approach it. And I pray that as we go into the rest of this service, that you would be all over it and that it would be all about you. We pray, God, that you'd be glorified in what happens, what is said, what is done here today. And it's all of these things that we ask and pray in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. How about a round of applause for these folks? All right. One other thing I need to do before we start moving on to other things. I believe we've got some folks in here that have been married for 51 years. Would that be Gary Clayton, please stand in the back? Come on, Gary. And Dana, who is right over here. Happy anniversary, guys. 51 years. That's amazing. 51 years. And 12 years ago today, I was listening to one lady say, I do, and I said, are you sure? No, I don't mean that, but Donald and Debbie Stan, 12-year anniversary today. And is there a Hunter Williams in the house? Stand up, Hunter. Happy birthday, buddy. And I'm not sure if Serena Clark is with us or not, but today is Serena's birthday as well. Well, this morning, as I said, it's Bible school time, and I think we're going to have a visitor throughout the week that we'd like to introduce you to today. So, is our visitor here today?
Well, hey, y'all. How are y'all doing? Are y'all here to catch the train to Salvation Station? Oh, my, with this crowd, I might need to get more tickets.
Hey, Smokey Joe, I already got my ticket.
How'd you get your ticket already?
Well, you know me, I won't go pay full price. So I went on Expedia and searched out the best rate and went ahead and got mine by email and printed it out. So there you go.
I guess that don't surprise me at all.
No, that's one train I didn't want to miss. I'm going to tell you that.
Yes, this train is one of the best. We got your all-time favorite crafty things to do. We got a special car just for game time. And we even got your absolute best meal car. Oh, yeah, I almost forgot. We gonna have music play.
Man, that sounds absolutely awesome. I can't wait. I am so glad I got my ticket ahead of time. I really see a lot of people out here, though. You think you're gonna have enough tickets?
Why, yes, sir. I'm glad you got your ticket, too. But I don't know if I have enough here. You know, that makes me think of another ticket that we might have ought to get ahead of time, too.
What ticket is that, and where does that train take you?
Well, to heaven, of course. Jesus came to earth and died and rose again to be sure he paid our ticket ahead of time for us to enter into heaven. Heaven is the destination we need to be headed to.
Yeah, that's right, Smokey. And you know the awesome thing about that train is the tickets ain't gonna run out. There's plenty.
That is for sure, Pastor. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life.
That's right.
We can all be a whosoever. Jesus is the only way, the only ticket we need to get on the gospel train to glory.
Okay, Smokey. Okay. If you start preaching, they're going to think we're going to say amen and go home, and it ain't happening.
I'm sorry, Pastor Dave. I get real excited about telling others about Jesus and that he's what he's done for me and what he can do for them.
It's all right, Smokey. I get excited about it, too. And that's what this week is all about, is helping these young people and the old folk figure out how to get on the train to Salvation Station.
Well, we're going to start up at 5 o'clock tonight right here with a good old meal. And then the whistle blows at 6:30. So y'all be ready to board.
Did you say something about a whistle blowing?
Yeah.
Boy, you know me, I love trains, Smokey Joe, and there's no prettier sound than that. Well, folks, listen, you heard Smokey Joe. Bible school starts tonight, but we're just a little bit early to get our tickets. So y'all be back here tonight at 5 o'clock, ready to have a good meal and kick off Bible school and figure out just how to get your ticket to Salvation Station unless you already have it. And if you do, then it shows us how to stay on track with Jesus. So come on and join us tonight, if you will. Smokey Joe, thanks for joining us. We'll see you later, old buddy.
Bye, y'all, and see you later at the station.
All right, time to dismiss for Children's Church. Ages 3 to 3rd grade, y'all head on out. Have fun and learn a lot today.
Turn, if you would, in your hymnals to page 483 for offertory hymn, Footsteps of Jesus. If everyone could please stand, 483 in your hymnals, Footsteps of Jesus.
Service personnel, Lord, medics and all, praise you, Jesus, and long as pray for David, Lord, as he stands today, say your word. The Lord bless in this offering, Lord, whatever done, we'll thank you, pray. Thank you, Christ. Amen. Amen.
Came to Jesus and I took my stand for what I surrendered was back in my hand, defeated by failure and haunted. My God, are you near?
He sent out your forgiveness.
Your forgiveness. Resting and growing in Him. my soul is at rest, and I still must rejoice when I think of the day that I heard His voice.
A relief I can't earn my way when I come up empty, my Father.
Man alive, we keep on. We're going to be riding the soul train. Oh, good stuff. All right, we've had the dessert first, it seems, so let's get into the main course now. Grab your word. Grab the Bible there and turn to Mark chapter 8. Now, that's a little foreign to you. For a little over a year, I keep getting up here saying, turn to the book of Ruth. Today, we are in the book of Mark. And that is right there early on in the New Testament, one of the Gospels. And I chose this particular passage because it lent itself so incredibly well today to our message entitled, On Track with Jesus. That's what Bible school is all about this week, is to know how to get on track with Jesus and how to stay on track with Jesus. Seems like it takes so very little to get us off track, doesn't it? But this week we look at this message. It's a very simple message. Most of the words that I will read today are in red, meaning that Jesus spoke them himself. Now that doesn't mean that every other word that's in a different color in your Bible isn't just as important, but if Jesus said it, my ears just tend to perk up just a little bit more, because that's him speaking in first person to us, and it just means something very special. So understand today that as I speak to you, these words in red are what Jesus speaks to you, not David. 1 week ago, at this very moment, Noah and I were in Italy. We were on a train traveling 220 miles per hour. I'm not exaggerating. It was called the Frecciarossa, and it was a fast train, to say the least, going 220 miles an hour, taking us from Pompeii, Italy, back up to Rome, where we were staying. I appreciate y'all letting us be away like that. That was one of the most special times ever. We sat up till 3 in the morning talking for like a week and a half, getting to know each other even better, even though we've been around each other all our lives, and it's time that I would never take anything for. But that particular time was really special to me because if you know me at all, you know that I am like sort of living the dream today. I love trains. Did y'all know that? I love trains. They just represent power and efficiency. And so I love everything to do with trains. So somebody said this morning, is that all your stuff around here? Most of it. Yeah, I mean, I had a little help, but most of it's mine. And even the tracks and the ties I stand on now are mine because Brother Wayne made sure I got it, but he said, I don't want it back. So somehow they go into my house and they're going to be a pathway somewhere. So I'm sort of loving this. You know, I love to preach the Word of God with all my heart, but I also love trains. So what better to be able to preach the Word of God in a train station entitled Salvation Station? But being on that train last week just sort of piqued my interest of trains even more, especially one that goes 220 miles an hour. So we're sitting there, we're flying across the Italian countryside. There are olive groves with olive trees as far as the eye can see. Tomatoes everywhere. I just wanted to get off and grab one and just bite it. I haven't had a really good tomato yet this year. But tomatoes everywhere, lemon trees everywhere, and almond trees everywhere. Beautiful countryside, mountainous terrain, and every now and then you get a view of the ocean. That was just incredible. But as we were riding on that train a week ago, an interesting thing took place. I saw that there was a guy sitting over there that was dressed a little nicer than the rest of us because, you know, we're in Europe. People just really don't dress all that great and apparently don't bathe often either. And if you happen to be European, I'm sorry, but they're just a little ripe. So this guy stood out as different because he was all decked out, nice suit and all that, and I could tell something different. And I could tell he was frustrated about something. You could just see it on somebody, right? You could tell. People aren't good at hiding it. You can read them. And I could tell he was frustrated about something. And he kept looking up on the wall at that little screen with the speedometer on it. And it was in kilometers, but evidently he knew exactly what it was doing. Me, I'm having to do the conversions. I'm like, oh, okay, about 220. Anyway, he kept looking at that thing. And when it was all said and done and we had stopped there in Salerno, he walks up to the conductor and he's just letting him hold it in Italian. And I'm only able to make out a little bit of it, but then he starts fussing at him in English. So I'm like, this thing got serious now. He is. I mean, when you get cursed out bilingually, something's wrong. So anyway, he's letting this guy hold it who's driving the train. And basically what is happening is he says, you know we're not supposed to go over 215 miles an hour. And you were going 220 the whole way. And the guy said, that's just not true. I was doing exactly 215. He said, no, you were doing 220. I saw it. He said, well, my speedometer said 215, and you never did pass me, so I must have been doing 215. That's so not true. I'm sorry. But, you know, think about that. What good is a train car that is hooked to an engine that's supposed to be in charge, supposed to be taking you down the tracks, if it's not hooked? What good is it? Not very much good at all. Momentum may take you a little ways. If you've ever seen that movie Unstoppable, you know that it can get crazy. Things can keep moving by momentum and just pull along for a while. But eventually, you're either going to derail because you can't be controlled, or you're just going to stop going anywhere at all. And so even though we did not pass that guy, and we weren't overspeeding, we were hooked on just fine, I would submit to you that there are a lot of folks who wear the name of Christ who would say, as that old song, their life is like a mountain railway with an engineer is true. I would say that those who have said we believe that oftentimes uncouple ourselves from the engine. You know, that's what those things are called. Those knuckles that grab together on a train, they're called couplers or knuckles. And I'd say that I see folks on a regular basis who claim the name of Christ, who claim to be hooked to the engineer that is true, leading us to Salvation Station in the sky. I'd say that we uncouple pretty regularly. Why do you say that, Pastor? Because I see Christians doing things that Christians shouldn't do. I see them on tracks that just aren't leading to where God would be taking them. Well, I'm doing my best to follow God. You ain't doing too good if what you're doing doesn't add up to what the Scriptures teach us. And it's not right. You see, we're going about our business every day, supposedly trying to get other people on board this glory train. And yet, if we're not hooked on ourselves, if we're not coupled to that engineer that's true, the only one that really knows the way that we're supposed to be going, if we're blazing a trail of our own, at best, we're going to make a few feet, and then we're going to stop. And so I would submit to you, we need to figure out how to make sure we do stay on track with Jesus. We can't pass up the engineer. Can't pass him. We don't know where to go if we do so. You can't just sit on a side rail somewhere like folks do in the pews so often and not serve, because that's not following along. You're not going to sit still and go with a dynamic God. You're just not going to do it any more than a trained car is going to move without its engine. And so today is all about truly staying on track with Jesus. Last Thursday, we were able to spend some time in France, and we had gone to the tomb of Napoleon. You say, why would you do that? Because I could. I didn't know Napoleon, wasn't a dear friend, not in my lineage, but Napoleon was a huge figure in history. And for all his faults, was an incredible strategist. And so I thought, let me just go see what this is all about. And I got there expecting to see this little bitty short casket, because he was always picked on about being a short guy. And there's this gargantuan mahogany box, hand-carved, that wouldn't have fit on this stage. And I thought, wow, what a pompous fella he was. But anyway, there was Napoleon's tomb, but also this huge museum of World War I and World War II in this church called Les Invalides. And so we were walking through that, and as I told Sister Kathy this morning in her Sunday school class, as I walked up to one display, I knew exactly what I was preaching today. Because I walked up to this one display, and there were parts of a steam locomotive that were all to pieces, and they had reconstructed the scene a bit and had some of the pieces there. I mean, guide rods from a train engine this big that were snapped in half somehow. And then this picture of this huge wreck during World War II. I began to read about it, and what I found was that this train had been derailed by the Nazis by something no bigger than a quarter. They had a little device that was no bigger than a quarter, and they laid it on the track here. They knew the train was coming with supplies and with troops, and they laid it on there, and it had a fuse running from it, run off to some explosive, all very well concealed, but something the size of a quarter. They had one of the devices sitting there. And as the train hit that, the explosives went off and derailed that train. The troops nor the supplies got where they were going. And I would submit to you that it takes so very little to derail us. And folks, I want with all my heart for every one of you here today, and for everyone on this planet for that matter, to stay on track with Jesus. Not to be derailed by the sinful things that the enemy will place in your path, just as the Nazis did in World War II. And so as we read this, frame it in that state of mind. Mark chapter 8, starting at verse 27. Mark chapter 8, starting at verse 27 and running through verse 38. And Jesus went out and his disciples into the town of Caesarea Philippi. And by the way, he asked his disciples, saying unto them, whom do men say that I am? And they answered, John the Baptist. But some say Elias, and others, one of the prophets. And he saith unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Peter answereth and said unto him, thou art the Christ. And he charged them that they should tell no man of him. And he began to teach them many things, and be rejected of the elders and of the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he spoke that saying openly, and Peter took him and began to rebuke him. But when he had turned about and looked on his disciples, he rebuked Peter, saying, get thee behind me, Satan, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men. And when he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. And whosoever shall save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, that same shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father and with the holy angels. Let us pray. Father, thank you. Thank you that we have truly had church here today. We have enjoyed spending time together in fellowship. We have enjoyed spending time together in worship. We have listened to a beautiful song reminding us that we are forgiven and free. But Lord, that came at an incredible price. It came at the price of your own blood, of your only begotten Son. And so today, help us to turn our attention now to that which set us free, that which forgave us, Jesus. And I pray that we would be able to find our way on track with you and to stay securely fastened and coupled to you, our engine and engineer, that we might end up exactly where you want us each and every day of our lives. Bless the reading and the hearing of your word, and God, move in this place today as only you can. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So as we pick this apart, you see sort of what's happening. That Jesus has been about his ministry. They go out into this area of Caesarea Philippi. And as they are, he's just sort of trying to have a conversation with his fellows. And he's trying to get in teaching points. If you look at Jesus' life, everywhere he's going, he's having normal, down-to-earth human conversations. But he's always trying to bring in a deeper spiritual truth. What do we talk about? Is your speech something that is something that matters, that's weighty, that approaches the things that are eternal, or is everything that we talk about just surface-level fluff? You know, it's interesting. Sit around sometimes at the mall. Just grab a bench sometimes and listen to people's conversations. Or jump in a car with somebody, a few people, and listen to their conversations. Or just stand around in Walmart or Rose's somewhere in the grocery store and just eavesdrop a little bit. Is that okay, Pastor? Well, you do it anyway, so you might as well. So just eavesdrop a little bit. What are people talking about? The weather. Really? It ain't a doggone thing we can do about it, so why bother? Well, yeah, it's sunny outside. It's going to rain tomorrow. Okay, that's conversation, but really isn't going anywhere, is it? Nothing you can do about it. Or maybe they're talking about sports, and I'll ask you this one. I love sports, but what game that you've ever watched or played in has ever had eternal consequence on your life? Maybe it's about some hobby you've got. I just told you I love trains, but how many of you want to sit around and listen to me babble on about model trains all day long? Because I can do it. I love it. One of my favorite pastimes for years was getting these old trains that people didn't know what they had that were tore out of pieces on eBay for a little or nothing, fixing them up, making them run, and then having something that was worth a small fortune. Love that. But you don't want to sit around and talk about it, and it really doesn't have any great consequence in life, does it? What I'm getting at is those things are not inherently bad, but it's time that we got down to business realizing that time is short. Scripture tells us to redeem the time. In other words, make sure that what you are doing has those eternal consequences. It goes along with that passage in Matthew where Jesus said, lay not up for yourself treasures on earth where moth and rust corrupt, but lay up for yourself treasures in heaven. How do you do that? Get down to the nitty-gritty and start talking about Jesus and how to get on track with him with the folks around you. We are surrounded by people who don't know the Lord, y'all. And we're surrounded by people who claim to know the Lord that ain't a bit more living for him than the rocks out in the driveway. We need to get down to some weighty matters, and he's getting down to that. And he just, all out of the blue, it seems like, says, hey, guys, who do people say I am anyway? And he's going for something deep here. It may seem just sort of frivolous, but he's going for something deep. Who do men say that I am? Well, a couple of them said, well, they say maybe you're John the Baptist reincarnate, or you're Elijah. Maybe Elijah's come back, because we know there was a scripture that says the spirit of Elijah will revisit us. And then others say you're just one of the great prophets. Let me tell you something. Everything that you believe in life should hinge upon this one thing, and that is who Jesus is. Because if he's John the Baptist, he can't save you. And he ain't the one you need to be coupled to and on track with. If he's just Elijah, he's just another one of the prophets. Elijah was the man now. Elijah was awesome. Read his writings. He was an incredible prophet of God and teaches us so much about practical living for the Lord. But Elijah can't save you. And if he's just one of the prophets, as many religions teach today, then we're in trouble. You know, I realize I'm about to trample all over a lot of toes here, but there are a couple of really fast-growing religions in the world today. And you say, you really shouldn't pick on other religions. I'm not. I'm just calling truth, truth, and a lie, lie. The Church of Latter-day Saints, which claim to be Christians, will tell you all day long that Jesus was just a God, not God. And then there's this fast-growing religion called Islam. Will tell you that Jesus was a prophet, but Muhammad superseded him. Folks, a partial truth is a whole lie, and those are lies. Amen. Who do you say Jesus is? Because the reality is he's not John the Baptist. He's not Elijah. He's not a prophet. He is the Son of God, and he is God. Say, I have a hard time wrapping my mind around that. Well, do you really want to serve a God that you can explain away? Not me. My word tells me that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. The Word is Jesus Christ, and he is God. So he's asking, who do you say I am? Because, folks, that is the main question you need to ask in your life. Who is Jesus to you? And he should be your Savior, your Lord, and your engineer. And I pray that today, if you don't get anything else, you understand that the most important thing you will do in life is either accept or reject Jesus Christ as your engineer and your Lord. I hope that you will answer this question that he asked. You are Jesus. You are God. And so we see in verse 9, he said, who do you say I am? Peter answered and said unto him, you are the Christ. And he is, folks. He is. He is the Christ and the only one that we should be behind and following through our life. And then it says he charged them that they should tell no man of him. You know, I really think there's some reverse psychology going on here. If you know the Christ, what are you going to do with that? Well, you're supposed to be telling everybody. And so what happens here is far deeper than I can get into theologically today, but I'll tell you this, in no way was he insinuating, don't go spread the gospel. This is another message for another time, but I really see a little bit of reverse psychology there because we know what they did. Not only did they go about telling everybody about who Jesus was, all of these disciples end up dying a martyr's death. One of the single most important things that I see in proof of Jesus Christ being who he said he was. Now, you know, we might believe in somebody and get behind them, but when things get tough and we might be persecuted for them, if they're not the real deal, are we going to stay behind them? No way in this world. I watch people step away from their friendships and loyalties all the time because it's getting ready to cost them something. Jesus must have truly been Christ. Because these men were willing to go to their grave claiming they knew it to be a fact. Well, that's a neat proof for me. Not that I need it. I believed it anyway. But they went and they told it. And then he went on to say, he began to teach them in verse 31 that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed and after 3 days rise again. He prophesies exactly what's going to happen. Now, you understand, he spoke this long before it happened. And is this not exactly what happened? Further proof of exactly who he was. But then Peter did what any good Christian should do. He's like, that ain't going to happen. I love you, Lord, and I don't want that to happen to you. I say any good Christian should do that because we should all defend what we believe and be ready to give a proof for it. But what Peter had done here was a little backwards because he was looking at earthly things. Jesus was telling him, this is the way it's got to be. This is the track that I've got to run to get where I'm going, where God wants me. And this has got to happen. Peter said, no way in the world I am not going to have this. And Jesus said, get thee behind me, Satan. Get thee behind me, Satan. You know, that's what he's going to say to us too. Not that we're the devil. Sometimes we act like it though. And if you get focused on the things of this earth instead of the will of God, you're headed the wrong direction, and he's going to have to rebuke you. And so that's what he's doing. Get thee behind me, Satan, for you savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that are of men. Folks, real important pointed lesson here. Keep your eyes on the engineer. Amen. You know, last week as I rode that train, all I could do was look out those windows at that beautiful scenery. And that's all well and good. But more than that, I needed to make sure that I'm focused on my engineer and that he's okay and that I'm following right where he wants me to go. Keep your eyes on the things that be of God, not the earth. And then he sort of switches gears. They get to a place where he's beginning to teach and they draw a crowd. It says, when all the people were together and his disciples also, he said, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Now, you've heard that verse a million times. Have you ever really thought of the depth of it? How many of you, if I were to ask you, and I'm actually asking for a little feedback here as I walk the tracks. I love this. Love this. How many of you have said at some point in your life, I want to follow Jesus? Would you raise your hand? Be proud of that thing. If you are, be proud of it. We'll talk about pride and shame in a minute. Okay. All right. So he said, if that be true, if you are one of those whosoevers, I love what old Smokey Joe Coltrane said earlier. We can all be a whosoever. That's one of Willis Parker's favorite sayings. We can all be a whosoever. If you are a whosoever and you've said, I want to follow Jesus, do you truly understand what that means? Because he said, if you're going to follow me, you've got to couple up with me just like a train car to an engine. That's exactly what it says here. I'm not trying to impose something on the text. He says, you must deny yourself Take up your cross and follow me. That follow me literally from the Greek means to adjoin yourself to, just like a train. It means to adjoin yourself to. Have you really adjoined yourself to Christ, and are you following him no matter where he leads? Or do you get terrified at the places that he tends to lead you and jump off the train here and there, just assuming like a hobo you can jump back on when you get ready? We're supposed to be adjoined to him, never to look back, never to let go, never to be derailed, never let anything get our focus off of him. He said, if you're going to follow me, you need to adjoin yourself to me, but it's going to mean something. You've got to deny yourself and take up your cross. Two ways of saying the same thing. What does it mean? Are you guys supposed to pick up a 20, 30-foot piece of lumber that was built as a torture device and carry it around with you all through the streets and through life? Let's hope not. Because most of us wouldn't be physically capable of doing that, at least not for long. You'd be pretty useless in God's hands if you had a real cross on your back trying to walk around with it. It would be nearly impossible. You wouldn't get much done. The cross represented sacrifice. So like I said, deny yourself, take up your cross. Two different ways of saying the same thing. Are you, as a follower of Christ, willing to sacrifice what it is that you want, what it is that you're after, the destination that you're wanting to head to get behind him, adjoin yourself to him, and follow him no matter what? I would submit to you, a lot of you have claimed to be Christian, but you didn't mean it because you didn't count the cost, as the scripture says. You didn't understand that it wasn't about you. You thought it was about you. You wanted some fire insurance. You wanted to feel better about yourself, and you wanted to get to heaven. When you have to understand that in order to truly be adjoined to Jesus Christ, there's not just salvation at stake. There is a lordship issue. There is accepting him as your engineer, adjoining yourself to him, sacrificing your desires, your wants, your ambitions, your everything, and saying, I'm yours, and wherever you go, that's where I'm going. That's what he's saying. We're not real good at denying ourselves. It's against our human nature, isn't it? I want this. I want that. I don't like this and I don't like that. You know, that eye trouble is why we get so offended all the time. We live in the United States of the offended. We really do. People are just waiting to get ticked off about something. Waiting to find something to get on somebody about. Why? Because they're focused on self. And folks, I'm just here to tell you, you're not on track with Jesus if you're focused on Y-O-U. You ain't. Or as text has now turned the word you into just the letter U. If you're focused on you, you ain't focused on Jesus Christ. And you're not on track. And you're not going to find satisfaction or fulfillment, not in anything. Keep on buying all that stuff and enlarging your collections of whatever it might be. Fill in the blank. Whether it be money or stuff or friends, or love, or illicit relationships, or drugs, or whatever. You keep filling in the blanks. You will never find satisfaction as long as you are trying to satisfy Y-O-U. But if we will truly deny ourselves, take up that cross representing sacrifice, we can truly follow him. And we're going to be headed the right direction. Now this week, we're going to go through a series of lessons with these young people and adults alike, to sort of flesh this out, to show people what that looks like in practical terms. But here's a real easy way for you to take this message into your week and let it be something powerful for you. Each and every day, with each and every decision, won't you ask yourself, what is it that this is going to do to please the Lord? Instead of asking, what can I do to make my day better? What can I do to make my life better? And you know, if you get on track with Jesus and follow him, you know where you're going to be going to? Hospitals and nursing homes. You know why? Because where Jesus was going was to the sick and to the hurting. He wasn't spending his time on Facebook talking about good things and yapping about things that he wasn't willing to do anything about. He was going and doing something. You want to follow Jesus and be on track with him? Go to the sick and hurting and find a way to help. Find a way to be Jesus' hands and feet. I say it Wednesday after Wednesday. We should be instruments of peace and healing. God's hands and feet here on earth. And yet what we tend to do is talk about it. I wish somebody would. There's a song that plays on the radio. I don't have a clue the name of it. But it's a guy that keeps having this conversation with God. He's like, God, so many people are sick and hurting and they need this and that. Why don't you do something? And he said, I did. I sent you. You want to be on track with Jesus? Follow him. Follow him where? To the sick and the hurting. Read about his mission. He was doing it all the time. Jesus was drawn to the sick and hurting. And he said, I came to heal those who were sick. Because those who are well don't need a physician. Go to the sick and the hurting. It's going to take a little sacrifice. It's going to mean maybe not going out to eat. It may mean not going to do something like you want to do, like go sitting in your lazy boy and lazing and vegging out. But a little bit of denying self, a little bit of sacrifice is following him to the sick and hurting. What about the lost and dying? When's the last time you made an effort to witness to someone? God bless you, Honduras team. God bless you, Vermont team. God bless you, Alaska team. And every other person that has said, I will get on board with a mission because I believe in following Jesus to the lost and the dying. How comfortable does it make you feel to know that people are dying and going to hell by the minute when we could do something about it? All we're going to do is get them on track with Jesus. But we won't even talk to them about it because we're too busy talking about sports, the weather, and other things. You want to really follow Jesus? Deny self. Find a way to have a mission. And you don't have to get on a bus or an airplane to do it either, because right outside those doors, there are people who need Jesus Christ. You probably have neighbors or family members that you're around by default that need Jesus Christ. You know, it always bugs me when people are ready to jump on board with a mission trip when they won't even witness here. Man, it ain't an adventure. It ain't a vacation. That's part of it. But a mission trip should be an extension of doing what you're already doing in your normal life. People need the Lord. And if you're following Jesus, Jesus was going to the lost and the dying. It's time we did the same. Where else was Jesus going? Everywhere the Lord led him to be an example. Are you an example to this world, wherever you might be, of what Christ looked like? I want you to think for just a moment now, for those of you who work. Would the people you work with, would the people you work for, would the people who work for you stand up and say, that is an incredible Christian lady? That is an incredible Christian man. They are truly living out their faith. Or are you that person that compartmentalizes your life, and when you're at work, you turn it off, and you're happy to curse like a sailor? You're happy to be ill-spirited with people and push them around, whether you're the boss or the employee, and that's never okay. Do you think Christ acted like that? If you do, show me where. I don't see it. Your work life is just an extension of your Christian life, not a different compartment. If you're in school, same thing. Do you do your best in school? As the scripture says, do everything you do as unto the Lord, heartily. Or do you just try to get by? That's part of your witness, folks. And do you share Christ with your friends, or are you afraid that they might kick you off their lunch table and you have to eat by yourself in the corner? I mean, you want to stay on track with Jesus? You go to the lost and the dying and the sick and the hurting, no matter where you are. School's not an exception. In fact, it's a beautiful mission field. For our young people in colleges and going off to these liberal institutions, I get it. You got a bunch of professors that are holdovers from the 60s that are still stuck in free love and smoking pot, whatever. You say, man, that's a terrible stereotype. I'm just calling it. That's what it is. They need the Lord too. And if you work hard, you might earn an audience with them. You slack off, they're going to say, it's just another reason I don't want to be a Christian. What about in your home life? Are you super Christian at church and then you go act like the devil everywhere else? Are you faithful to your spouse in every way? Not just physically, but emotionally and in every other way. Do you treat them with the respect that Jesus says treat them with? He says, husbands, love your wives like Christ loved the church. Yeah, he died for it, but he also sacrificed for it. Are you doing that in your relationships? Or is it still about YOU? That's not being on track with Jesus. You should be an example just like he was. Jesus was also walking about upholding the Word of God everywhere he went. Nowhere in the New Testament do you see Jesus tearing down the Old Testament. He came to fulfill it, not to tear it down. You say, well, there's things we don't do these days. Yeah, some things did change, but those things are clearly marked as to why. Such as why we worship on Sunday, the first day of the week, the Lord's Day, the day that he rose instead of Saturday. But he didn't come to tear it down, he came to fulfill it. He was upholding the Word of God everywhere he went. Are you? And I'm telling you the answer to it, no. You don't even want to engage in a theological conversation because it's uncomfortable. That's not on track with Jesus. Did you ever see him back down? Show me. He didn't back down not one time. He upheld the truth no matter what, even when people didn't like it, especially when people didn't like it. I'm not a confrontational person, buddy, but you're not going to talk me down on the Word of God. The worst you can do to me is put a bullet between my eyes and I'm going to say, hello, Jesus, and I'm good. I ain't backing down. I'm staying on track with him. I'm upholding the Word of God. Now, that's going to sound awful judgmental sometimes when you uphold the Word of God, and that's what's uncomfortable, but do it anyway. If the Bible says that thou shalt not and somebody is thou shalt doing, you need to tell them. That ain't going to work out for you because God said don't do it. You can't judge me. No, but God already did, and I get to stand with his judgment, and I love you enough to tell you it ain't right, and it's going to cost you. So let's get back on track. So Jesus was going to the sick and the hurting, the lost and the dying. He was being an example, and he was also upholding the Word of God. One last thing he was doing that if you really want to follow him, you'll do too. Jesus was loving every single person he came in contact with, even the hard-headed, sorry, knuckle-headed sinners. You know what we do when somebody's different? Even if they just look different. We don't even know if they're really different. Even if they just look different. You know what we do? We automatically pass a judgment into my mind that they are lesser than us and not worthy of what we have to offer. Amen. Say, I never did that, haven't we? Haven't we? You've heard the old story about the old man that comes into the church. He's smelly. He's dressed in all these ugly clothes. And I don't know if it's true or not, but it's told as a true story. He's sitting back there in the back, and everybody moves away from him. Nobody speaks to this guy. Nobody says a word. And then the chairman of the deacons gets up, and he said, after long last, after searching for 18 months, our new pastor is here for the first time today, and I'd like to invite him up. And everybody's looking around to try to find the pastor. Where's this new pastor? We're so excited. He's got all these doctorates. He's supposed to be all that and a bag of chips. Where's he at? He's the man sitting on the back row that everybody walked away from because he was smelly, wearing dirty, ragged, tattered clothes. He walks up and he says, if we can't change what I just witnessed in here, we are a church not at all. We're not a church at all because we're not following Jesus, because Jesus went straight to people like that. Read the book. The people that Jesus hung out with, we would ostracize in a flat minute. But it's time that we loved all. You know, last week, it's no secret, we were on a trip, me and Noah, after his graduation. It's a trip that's been planned for over 10 years. And again, I wouldn't take the world for it. We started off in London, England. And let me tell you, everywhere we went, something bad happened. But God protected us, thank God. I might have think, did I bring the bad? But anyway. So we start off in London, England. And one of the things that Noah wanted to do on this trip was to go to every Hard Rock Cafe. He wanted to get a t-shirt from every Hard Rock Cafe in these countries we went to. So we went to the original right there where Eric Clapton started the whole thing. And we sat there under Eric's guitar enjoying our meal. And let me tell you what Noah got. We go all the way to London, Noah gets chicken tenders. So we're eating chicken tenders there at the Hard Rock Cafe, and I look up over the bar where Eric Clapton's guitar hangs, and it says this, love all, serve all. Then we got on a plane, we went down to France, we went to Paris, and we went again to the Hard Rock Cafe. We walked into the Hard Rock Cafe, and we look up on the wall, and in great big letters right over the Hard Rock logo, love all, serve all. We get on a plane, we fly down to Rome. The very next night, we go to the Hard Rock Cafe. We get there in Rome to the Hard Rock Cafe, and once again, we're eating chicken tenders. And I look up on the wall, and in even bigger letters than the one in Rome, and all the way around, it repeating itself, love all, serve all. Jesus was doing that very thing. You know who we're loving the most? Ourselves. Ourselves. That's where most of the focus is at. And notice that I said who we. I'm not picking on y'all. I do it too. I'm human. We get so focused on self. And we love self and serve self. If you're on track with Jesus, you're going to the sick and the hurting, the lost and the dying. You're going to be an example of what Christ will look like. And it's right here. It tells you how to do it. You're going to be upholding the Word of God. And you are going to be loving every single human being you come in contact with. You know why? Because God does. They may look different. They may act different. They may be different. They may get on your nerves. But if you can somehow compartmentalize your heart and say, I choose not to love that person, something is fundamentally wrong with you and you are not on track with Jesus Christ. The meanest, the low-downest, the ugliest, dirtiest sinner is just as good as you in the eyes of God. The only difference in us and them is that we're forgiven and you need to show them how to be. And if you don't, you are not behind the engineer Jesus Christ, because that's who he was going to. There's only one engine, folks. You better adjoin yourself, couple yourself, hook yourself into Jesus and go wherever he's taking you. And do those things that he's telling you to do. And I've given you some practical ideas of where Jesus is headed. Attach yourself and stay on track. Just give you a couple of equations to think about as we close today. You can either do as this passage says and deny yourself and take up your cross and follow Christ. Lose your life for his sake and forsake the world. And then what comes out of that equation is this. You get to keep your soul and share his reward and glory. Or you can make this choice. And there's really only one or two. It's either that one or this. Live for yourself. Ignore the cross. Follow the world. Save your life for your own sake. Gain the world, but lose your soul and lose his reward and glory. You see, the train really does have two set of tracks. And if you're following the devil, which is the only other alternative, you're headed to that point of a lost soul, an eternal damnation. And that ain't the one Jesus wants you on. If you do, you jumped on yourself. Or you can get on the one that Jesus is driving straight to glory. I wonder, will you hear the words of Jesus? Deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow him. He finishes with this. He says, because at the end of the day, what does it profit a man to gain the entire world and lose his soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? So two of the most important questions you will ever have to ask in your life and answer. Who is Jesus to you? He is the Christ. If you reject that, you're done for. And the second most pointed question is this. What are you willing to exchange for your soul? I hope you are on track with Jesus. I hope you'll stay there. Let us pray. Father, thank you. Thank you that these folks have sat so patiently and heard your word and your truth. We've had an incredible time in your house today. We've been blessed by good music, good fellowship. We've recognized some very special people today. But more than all of that, we've heard some very pointed truths from your word. I pray that every person in here has asked and honestly answered that question, who do people say you are? You are the Savior of the world. You are our Lord. You are God. I pray that everyone has come to that conclusion. I pray that we have coupled ourselves to you, that we are willing to deny ourselves, pick up our cross, representing sacrifice, daily sacrifice, and that we will truly adjoin ourselves to you and follow you forever, no matter what it costs, because we're not going to lose a thing that you're not going to replace with something better. Help us to quit playing around with what we're doing, quit jumping on and off the train, and truly get on board with you. Lord, I pray that in this invitation, people will just do serious business with you. That we'd not get ahead of the tracks, get off the tracks, or avoid you altogether, but that we'd do real business with you. And Father, I even pray now that if nothing else, these folks would pray for Bible school, that others might get on track with you as we show these young people and adults alike who you are. But more than anything, God, I just pray for your will in this time. And I pray it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Our invitation hymn, pretty appropriate for the message. Wherever he leads, I'll go. You know, if you're coupled with him, that's the way it's going to be. Stand and sing this morning. Do business with him. I'm here if you need to pray. Anything else you need to do, you come. But at the very least, you just follow God's direction. much for being here today. I hope you will repeat this tonight. And let's see, tomorrow night, and Tuesday night, and Wednesday night, because we're having what? Well, most of you know. It's Bible school. And so there we go again. Share it with somebody. Better yet, remember what I told you? Go get someone and bring them with you. Go find some kids in your neighborhood and bring them. That's exactly what Jesus would have done. I'll guarantee it. So bring some folks in, not just so we fill a place up. We're good at doing that. But let's fill the place up with people who need to hear about Christ and need to know how to be on track with Him. As we close today in prayer, may God go with you. Be safe. Follow the Lord no matter what, because it will never cost you anything that you'll ever really miss out on. And love on some of these survivors that you saw today. I bet you some of you are saying, I didn't realize they had dealt with cancer. That's one of the reasons we do that too. So love on them. Pray towards Relay for Life. And keep those bulletins with you through the week. And look at those activities. Pray what God would have you be a part of here at Antioch Baptist Church. As we close today, John Hall, would you please close us in prayer, brother? And I hope to see you again real soon this evening. Thank you.